Death, is it a blessing or is it the greatest evil? If people become immortal, what will happen to the world? Would it lead to total collapse, overpopulation, dystopia, the endless rule of dictators and a handful of billionaires who were the only ones rich enough to afford anti-aging medicines? Would life lose its meaning? Would humanity rot? Or would it be the exact opposite? As many of you know, I'm a transhumanist. This means that I support the idea that people need to improve themselves through technology and science. This includes fostering their health and productivity, which is called biohacking, and eventually doing all we can to defeat aging and, when possible, even death itself. I've got a separate video in which I discuss transhumanism and modern scientific approaches to immortality. There I touch upon regenerative medicine, nanomedicine, genetic engineering, digital immortality, and other possible ways to achieve immortality with references to actual scientific studies. You'll find the link in the description below. Whenever I tell people about transhumanism, there's someone who begins arguing against immortality. In today's video, I objectively go through the basic counterarguments, and I reply to all of them. My name is Greg Mustreader, and this is my channel on rationality, productivity, transhumanism, and new trends in society. Let's go! Many people say, sure, immortality is good, but only a handful of people will eventually get access to it. Evil billionaires will buy off the medicines for themselves and won't give them to common people. Dictators will rule forever, keeping the anti-aging medicines for themselves and themselves alone. This idea is supported by mass culture in film, in TV shows, for instance, the amazing Netflix series Altered Carbon, and other great productions reproduce this idea. I have to watch the second series, but don't have the time. Okay. In truth, however, things won't go like this. We can be sure of it by looking at history. Every groundbreaking new medicine becomes, with time, more and more accessible. For example, penicillin, discovered by Alexander Fleming in 1928, was the first antibiotic. It was a revolutionary discovery. In the last decades, it has saved, without exaggerating, hundreds of millions of people. Before its discovery, people would regularly die from even simple bacterial infections. Then this substance appeared. At first, penicillin was sold at a very high price. It was expensive to produce. But then it became cheaper, and during the Second World War, it was widely used and saved lots of lives. The elites did not buy and keep the antibiotic only for themselves. This did not happen. The fact is that the anti-aging medicine will very probably be not a single medicine. It's not like one day you'll swallow a pill and become immortal. More likely, it will be multiple medical interventions. Regarding this, I advise you to watch a video podcast I recorded with the world expert on aging, Aubrey de Grey. The link's in the description. Aubrey identifies 7 types of damage that occur during aging. You can see them on the screen. For each type of damage, scientists are researching methods to prevent them. How to stop the deterioration of the organism or neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's and so on. If we succeed in preventing all those types of damage, we will consequentially stop the entire process of aging. Essentially, aging is nothing but the wear of the body, accumulating over time. The different systems of our organism wear out and stop functioning. So, it's practically impossible to manage all this with one medicine only, which a single person and his entourage would be able to acquire and keep for themselves. That's simply impossible. There is another argument showing that biotechnologies for the prevention of aging will become more accessible with time. The majority of technologies become cheaper with time. For instance, the first deciphering of a human genome in 2003 cost $3 billion. Now you can take a DNA test for $300. That is 10,000 times cheaper. Many other complex technologies got much less expensive with time. Once, computer and smartphones were also luxury items, while nowadays almost everybody has one, even in less wealthy countries. The first Kodak digital camera came at a price of $30,000 and a resolution of 1.3 megapixels, which is laughable. Nowadays, you can buy at a price that is 50 times lower a basically professional camera with a cinema level of resolution, just like mine. Here's another argument. It's not wise for governments to keep anti-aging medicines and technologies from the population. Nowadays, governments are spending on healthcare trillions of dollars, an average of 10-15% of their GDP. A considerable part of this money is spent on care for the elderly. This contributes to an enormous burden for the healthcare system, which can be avoided by preventing aging amongst the whole population. Any leader, even a dictator, would see that curing aging would allow him to save enormous amounts of money. Of course, optimization is not always the first priority of governments, and pharmaceutical industries have strong lobbies, decisions are taken slowly, bureaucracy, there will probably be people wishing to hinder the development and the distribution of cures against aging. But still, the advantage of widespread access to such technologies would be too great. What's more, technologies allowing for a considerable lengthening of life expectancy would allow people not to retire anymore. This is particularly important for highly qualified jobs, and this would lead to a growth of the GDP. There are also lots of other positive side effects. Sure, a fair question would be, what are we going to do with all these people and all their jobs? If you have any idea on how to deal with this issue, please write it in the comment section below. Very possibly, we'll need to increase welfare spending or introduce UBI, Universal Basic Income. I'll certainly discuss this in other videos. And of course, these technologies can lead to enormous profits for their producers. I'm convinced that the first trillionaire will be the guy who starts mass-producing anti-aging medicines. Another counter-argument is the mistaken belief that eternal life would mean eternal aging. This is not the case. If experts succeed in finding a way for humans to conquer death, it wouldn't mean that everyone would become old, decrepit, and have Alzheimer's. On the contrary, it would mean successfully stopping the aging process in various systems in our organism and preventing illness. This would allow us not only to live forever or almost forever, but to live a healthy life free of illness, rather than an eternal life lived in old age. All that's required is the correct maintenance of our organism, as Aubrey de Grey puts it. Therefore, the radical prolongation of life would lead to a long, healthy life. Not the life of an old, senile person, not the life of someone old and decrepit. Perhaps it won't be possible to conquer all types of threats to our organism, although scientists are already making progress in various experiments on animals. But if it proves impossible, then the only path to immortality would be digital immortality, which I spoke about in my previous video on transhumanism. In such a scenario, we wouldn't have to become decrepit and old. Our digital copies would achieve immortality, and so the counter-argument doesn't hold here. Another popular argument is that if we radically extended human life, there would be overpopulation and not enough resources. To start with, if we were to take all the people on Earth and stand them shoulder to shoulder in a circle, it would have a radius of 80 kilometers, so they would be able to fit in a square the size of Houston or a little bigger than LA. There are a lot of areas on Earth that haven't yet been conquered, and huge expanses that are practically uninhabited. For example, there is a region in Russia, in Siberia, called Yakutia, which is the size of India. India is home to almost 1.5 billion people. Yakutia has a population of less than a million and a population density of 1 person per 3 square kilometers. So we are still far from having exhausted the planet's resources. According to the calculations of various academics shown on the screen, the Earth is capable of holding dozens of times its current population, possibly even hundreds. With regards to the shortage of food, Each year, food technology becomes more advanced and cheaper. Take artificial meat, for example. New, more effective agricultural technology is constantly being introduced. The rate of technological growth far outstrips the rate of population growth. Therefore, when it comes to lack of food, the counterargument doesn't really hold. Of course, there is the question of ecological problems, global warming, energy resources, and so on. They absolutely need to be resolved. However, if people are to live longer and have access to more advanced technology, they should be able to compile a large enough bank of experience and knowledge between them. This will make the probability of finding a solution to all these problems much higher. At the end of the day, we still haven't given up on the idea of gradually colonizing space, extracting resources from other planets and stars, and so on. At the moment, a lot of this might seem like science fiction, but in a few decades' time, it no longer will, you'll see. In my opinion, one of the most sound arguments against fighting aging is that eternal life would stop generations from renewing. How has everything always worked in the history of humanity? Old generations have died and made way for the young. Young people have more brain plasticity, less of a blinkered view on things, and they introduce new ideas and trends into society, advancing the whole of humanity forward. Look at the graph on the screen. History shows that great people, academics, writers, artists, philosophers, create their fundamental works at the average age of 40. After 60, they normally stop producing anything of note and start to decline. There are exceptions, of course, but we should treat them as such. If our fight against the aging process were to succeed, the old generation wouldn't make way for the young. There would be a gerontocracy. Nobody would die, and so the old generation would have the most experience, most money, connections, resources, they would occupy the most important positions in society, and they may well be unwilling to give them up to the younger generation. As a result, society could stagnate, and there could be less opportunities for young people. I think this could all become a real problem. Future politicians and thinkers would have lots of arguments over it. And they would probably think of various ways to deal with it. Let me know your ideas in the comments, by the way. I'd be interested to read them. In any case, I don't believe that this problem is so huge that people should die as a result. I believe that we should make way for the young, but this should under no circumstances come at the price of the lives of the elderly. I'm sure that reasonable solutions will be found. For instance, limits on the duration of occupying the same role in politics and in corporations. And besides, if early people have good health and are unaffected by the aging of the brain, they might well be just as open-minded and unblinkered as the young. In general, it would be interesting to try and think about how society will look into the future. I'll do that in my further videos. Another significant group of arguments against transhumanism are religious counterarguments. For some reason, there are some religious people who believe that religion is incompatible with the fight against aging. However, in principle, the ideas of transhumanists don't actually stand in contradiction with any religion, or at least not with any of the major religions. Despite the fact that many religions emphasize the afterlife and its priority over life on Earth, if a person gets ill, believers still pray for their recovery and thank God if he allows their relative to live longer and recover from an illness. In addition, there are references in the Old Testament to old centenarians, whom you could call the first transhumanists. For example, Methuselah is supposed to have lived 969 years. Rather than being condemned for this, he is written about in a positive light, and he is described as a so-called forefather. Another example, in Christianity, it is said that Jesus brought dead people back to life, and that his disciples could do the same. It is precisely for this reason that there exist Christian transhumanists, Jewish transhumanists, and various associations and currents that unite transhumanism and religion. While religious views are not the most widespread ones among transhumanists, I repeat, there is no rock-hard religious argument against the prolongation of life that I know of. Finally, some critics of transhumanist ideas believe that without death, life loses its meaning. Or, at any rate, it becomes less exciting. You would no longer cherish every moment, knowing that in front of you lies a whole eternity. You wouldn't have to hurry anywhere or rush to create a great piece of art. You could end up wasting away your life rather than spending it in the most useful way possible. In response, of course, you could argue that even in today's world, people view their life in such a way. Not many people think regularly about death on a deeper level. In fact, evolution has given us mechanisms to avoid such thoughts. We rarely think about death, and when we do, it's normally because it has come to threaten us or someone close to us. But we should think about it. We should all think about it. Since death is a great tragedy that has been happening to society since the very beginning of its existence, and a great tragedy that continues to decimate tens of millions of people each year. While you watched this video, a few thousand people in this world died, and every one of those deaths is awful. Every one of us is immortal until we know how to prevent it. And if we don't put in the necessary effort, perhaps we will never learn. We must think more often about death. Memento mori. But let's return to the argument that people living eternally will waste away their lives and be in no hurry to do anything. Unfortunately, this argument cannot be proven or disproven by experiments because we have not yet achieved immortality. Regardless, however, I think the argument isn't quite accurate. Yes, most likely people won't be in a great rush to live when they have an endless scope of time measured out for their existence. People will be more likely to chill and spend time doing things they like. However, that doesn't mean they won't do anything at all worthwhile or won't value anything. Me and my transhumanist friends and acquaintances have discussed this topic on many occasions. We have reached the conclusion that, on the contrary, immortality would give us more strength and more impetus to develop ourselves and to achieve great things. Just the thought of how much you could manage to get done should motivate you. Here is a small disclaimer. In this video, I've been using the term immortality for convenience. However, immortality in its purest form is unlikely to be achievable. Firstly, radical life extension and victory over aging would not guarantee that you couldn't die of, say, a brick falling onto your head. Only digital immortality could save you in such a scenario. The loading of consciousness into a cloud or a digital storage. I spoke about it in my previous video on transhumanism, link below. However, there is no proof that digital immortality is achievable. And even if it were, it wouldn't take away the fact that in a few trillion years, the universe will freeze, all stars will die, all matter in the universe will disintegrate, and only black holes will remain. Therefore, in any case, I would like to reassure those who are worried about the idea of immortality. All things considered, our lives are, in any case, finite. And I'm sure that euthanasia will soon become legal everywhere and will soon offer a way out for those who are fed up with such a long life. Some people say that eternal life or a very long life would get boring, or that you wouldn't have enough to do to fill hundreds of years, let alone thousands. Here's a quote from my favorite book, Harry Potter and the Methods of Rationality. The protagonist in it answers the question of what he could do with eternity. By the way, if you haven't already, you should definitely read this book. It's a must read. Meet all the interesting people in the world, read all the good books, and then write something even better. Celebrate my first grandchild's 10th birthday party on the moon. Celebrate my first great-great-great-grandchild's 100th birthday party around the rings of Saturn. Learn the deepest and final rules of nature. Understand the nature of consciousness. Find out why anything exists in the first place. Visit other stars. Discover aliens. Create aliens. Rendezvous with everyone for a party on the other side of the Milky Way once we've explored the whole thing. Meet up with everyone else who was born on old Earth to watch the sun finally go out. Beautiful, isn't it? If you like this video, make sure to like and comment so as to support the promotion of it through YouTube's algorithms. Also, become a patron of my projects on Patreon to get access to exclusive content from me and to become a member of my book club and a community of rationalists, transhumanists, and effective altruists. All this can be found on patreon.com/gregmustreader. Link is in the description. See you next week.